Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, the daily contemplation. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddhist noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 48, recorded on the 9th December 2016 on planet Earth, on the Knuckles Mountain, under the cypress tree, at the cypress hermitage, in a quiet day, just before the rains. There are four questions, one simile, but first we take the normal intro as usual. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Before we start with the simile, I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to those who recently donated the cost for the website whatbuddhasaid.net and some of the software, security software and internet security servers and anti-hacker scanning and so forth are necessary to have a public website up and running today. They should know that since they have made this Dhamma sharing possible, all the Dhamma that is streaming out to 100,000 people every day from this website, they should know that they participate in partaking of the kamma, the probability of joy and happiness, and in particular freedom, future freedom, from donating these costs to the website. So thank you for those very good Buddhist people around the world that volunteered to come forward and donate the costs for the website and software. The first, we take the simile as usual, and it goes under the heading of swept away. Because Buddha lived in the northern India, then he used metaphors, images, mainly from northern India. And because there's a very big river there called the Ganges, then the images or metaphorical speeches on a river image or metaphor is often found in the Tipitaka, in the sacred texts of the Buddha. And this one is called the river. And the text will be, and this heading or keyword, you can say, swept away. Swept away. So it's from the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, number 22, book 22, sutta number 93. It's called the river in the classic text. So the Buddha, he said some approximate idea, because imagine there is a swiftly flowing mountain river is roaring down. And along this river grows five things. There grows grasses and sawgrasses, creepers, reeds and bushes. Suppose a man, he falls down the river and then he's carried away, he's swept away. But he tries to hold on to these bushes and creepers and reeds and plants that is hanging down in the river from the side. But wherever he grabs into that, it breaks off. Or he cuts his hand. So he's just swept along. These five things growing on the bank of the river doesn't help him because they break off. The grass, which is like the body, is very fragile. So it breaks off almost for nothing. The sawgrass, if he grabs that, then he cuts his hand because it's very sharp. That's like feeling. The creepers, they're very slippery and they break at the root. So they like perception. And the reeds, they are torn out to sheds. They are torn out to the sheds. It's like mental construction. And the bushes, they come out by the root. Whole bush come out by the root because it's moist soil there on the riverbank. That's like consciousness. So though he can grasp on and cling to these five things intermediary, they doesn't save him by getting swept along this mountain river. What is he swept along by? He's swept along by ignorance. His own ignorance of the Four Noble Truths. He's swept around by his own habits, desires, and cravings. He's swept along by the flood of his own mental defilements and the doings he's doing, performing under the influence of these mental impurities, these mental defilements, the kilesas. He's swept along by this karma, this probability that he will meet in the future and that he cannot escape, that follow him like a shadow. He's swept along by that. So why is he swept along and why he's not saved by this clinging onto this form, feeling, perception, mental construction and consciousness, these reeds and bushes and creepers that's growing on the bank. Why is not? Because they are impermanent. Whenever he tries to cling onto them, they fall down in his head or they cut his hand. So these impermanent things, they cannot save him. Then the Buddha says, it's like this uninstructed, ordinary, uneducated worldling, Buddhyana, that doesn't know the Noble One's teaching, that is not interested in the Noble One's teaching, that doesn't pay attention to the Noble One's teaching, and therefore do not come to understand the Noble One's teaching. They think that the body is the self, or feeling, mental construction, and consciousness is the self, or consciousness is the self. Or they think that there is a self inside the body, the feeling, the perception, and the mental construction and consciousness. Or they think that consciousness and the body, feeling, the perception, the experience, and the mental constructions, they are inside a self, hidden inside somewhere. And because they think to it, they try to cling on to this reeds and creepers on the riverbank. But still, because of impermanence, this river of change, of instability, they're swept along. They're swept along. Later down, they will meet calamity and disaster. Why so? Because either they drown, or they knock their head on a river stone, or they fall out of a waterfall. But down in this river, they are definitely not safe. This is the river of samsara, the time ocean of suffering. He also said another place that one who is flowing down in this river and is carried along, of course they cannot help others to cross the river, because they are themselves inside the river and carried along. They're swept away. If they're swept away, how can they help others to cross? It's impossible. And this simile is meant for all disciples to think about whether they are still in the river or they have fully crossed. Fully crossed entails that one is awakened and stands up on safe on high, on dry land. But if one is still swimming, works with arms and feet there, maybe without even a raft of the Noble Eightfold Way, fully internalized by the mind, then one is swept away. Then it's too early to start to teach others, because one cannot get them to cross. Why not? Because when I have not direct experience of crossing oneself yet. So one should first do what one teach others. Then one will not be criticized. Another poem, also from the Samyutta Nikaya, is from book 1, 136, goes like this. It says it very, it's very terse, short, but it says it very well. Sappa attipito loco. The entire world is in flames. The entire world is going up in smoke. The entire world is burning. The entire world is vibrating. It's unstable. Not to be trusted. But that which does not vibrate or burn, which is experienced by the Noble Ones, where death has no entry, in that my mind delights. That which doesn't vibrate on the transience and instability of impermanence, and doesn't burn on any form of craving or any form of ignorance, and where death has no entry, that is Nibbana, neither more or less. In that, my mind also delights. So much for simile of the swept away, the one carried away by the current. Now we go to the questions. First question is question 159. Is it stealing to watch movies and listen to music on YouTube? It depends. So all music and fiction films, they have a copyright nowadays. So if one takes something with a copyright, then one takes something that is not given. We should think that about the precept about not stealing is mentioned in the thing. I undertake the training rule of avoiding taking anything that is not given. So if it is given, then it's okay to take it. If it's not given, then it's not okay to take it. So music on and films on YouTube can have two things. In general, YouTube is fairly good to solve copyright issues because they have neural networks to sense even short pieces of film or short pieces of music inside a film, and then they will notify the copyright owners, and then they can get the video taken down. So usually a video won't survive, let's say, 3 months being copyrighted. However, if it is copyrighted, then the copyright owners, they can say, okay, we allow our music or our film to be utilized on this man's or woman's video channel on YouTube, but then we'll have to have advertisement on the sides, and then we'll get the income from the advertisement. So this is a middleway solution. They don't need to take the video down, those who have put the video up, but they won't get the AdSense income that the Google pays out to those who are those who can receive this AdSense money. This goes into the copyright owners of the film and the music. So in general, music and film on YouTube can't be seen if they are stayed there more than 3 months. If they've been up more than 3 months, then usually all copyright issues have been resolved. So the copyright owners, they have been informed by email, by YouTube, Google, and they have taken a decision whether to let the video stand there or not. So one cannot say answer categorically on the question because there might be cases where the video still is copyrighted, but in general it is so. Of course, especially if it's a company that have the copyright who puts on the video, or the musician themselves that put on the video to make advertisement for themselves, then it's hard to think of that there's any copyright issues involved. But I would say, as a general rule, if it's just put on yesterday, then the copyright issues can still be in function. Then one should be very careful. Because then it is stealing to take in something that is not given, to watch this movie or watch this piece of music. If it's have stayed there more than 3 months, then one can be pretty safe that the copyright issues have been resolved. That is as close as I can come to a categorical answer on this issue. In general, all pirate software, pirated videos or pirated films or pirated music, or anything that has been kind of like where these copyright issues have been broken, this is regarded as stealing. Because one takes something that has not been given. One has not paid for it, so one still take it and use it. Maybe because the software code has been broken or something was very common before, not so much anymore. But taking something copyrighted is stealing. Question 159. Is it true that the mind doesn't die? Does the mind stop at Parinibbana, at entering Nibbana? Very good questions. A very difficult one, both of them, actually. The first, is it true that the mind doesn't die? No, that's not true. Because the mind actually arises and ceases every moment. And so one moment mind is just actually a momentary phenomena, like the physical reality is also a momentary phenomena. They arise and then they cease right where they arise. Then the new moment arises and ceases, a new moment arises and ceases. In quantum mechanics, it's called an event or an observation. Same thing. In Buddhism, it's called a Dhamma with long A/ Dhamma, one state. It's a fundamental state. Is it physical? No. Is it mental? No. Is it physical, mental? Yes, it is physical and mental at the same time. It is a state of nama rupa. So you can neither say it's completely physical, nor can you say that it's completely mental. It is both. One Dhamma. This arises and ceases billions of times per second. Billions of times per second. So quickly that we cannot perceive it. But it's discrete moments. Inside the single state of the Dhamma, and inside the single mental state, and inside the single event of mind, there nothing happens. It's a static thing. Just like the film on an old silhouette film that is projected up on a screen, it's a static picture. Then it comes a new state, new state, new state, like a new picture, mutual. When they are projected quickly in front of a lamp or in front of attention and projected up on the screen in the cinema or projected up on the screen of consciousness, then it appears as if there were dynamics, there were movements, a reality passing by. But actually it's just discrete states blinking. So mind does die. In every moment, mind dies. In every moment, each individuality, each process of these moments of physical mental reality, they arise and cease billions of times per second. So one undergoes death and rebirth billions of times per second. And so does the world out there, all these mountain trees and so on. Though the mind is blinking 17 times faster than the physical reality. And that's basically why it's mind over matter and not matter over mind. But that's another issue. So mind do die, and that even millions of times per second. But because it happens so fast, then it seems that it is a continual flow. But it's not continuous. It is contiguous, like pearls on a string. They are discrete. Each pearl is for itself. It's not like the string. It's continuous. But the pearls on the string is contiguous. So reality is a case of contiguity. It is not a case of continuity. Though our perception of it, our distorted, too slow sampling of this reality, of this contiguity, of this blinking, of this stroboscopic reality, is so slow that it appears to be continuity. But it is contiguity, blinking. Does the mind stop at Parinibbana? Difficult one. The best I can say is I don't know. And also, the text doesn't know, doesn't say what is on the other side of Parinibbana. Doesn't say what Nibbana is. It says a lot about what Nibbana is not. It's not an imagination. It is not an idealism. It is not a mental construction. It's not physical. It's not mental. There's no impermanence there. It's outside of time and space. It has no spatial characteristic. It has no temporal characteristic. But it doesn't say where the mind is. It does say, though, one thing. Are two things we can say is in the affirmative, in the positive sense. Mind, Nibbana is an object of the mind. Nibbana is an object of the mind. So far, so good. This seems to indicate that mind doesn't die at entering Nibbana. Another issue is that Buddha said on just before dying, on his deathbed, it's in the Dikkha Nikaya number 16, which explains his whole death process, the last 3 months of his life. The long discourses of the Buddha, Dikkha Nikaya number 16, which you see here. So he said, Ananda, after I'm gone, there will be some sectarians, some disputants. They will come and ask you, the blessed Buddha, he said that Nibbana is the highest happiness. Nibbana paranang sukkang. Superlative, highest happiness in the absolute sense. Nibbana paranang sukkang. Highest happiness. But since there is no feeling and no perception in Nibbana, how can you feel this happiness? Since there's no body, no feeling, no perception, no mental construction, and not even consciousness in Nibbana, how can you experience this happiness? And to them, you should there answer them in this way. Whatever happiness there is, that the Blessed One calls happiness. Whatever happiness there is, that the Blessed One calls happiness. And then he didn't say any more about it. And this is because Nirvana, the gone-out state, is not something that you can intellectualize. You cannot understand it. Why say? Because it's outside the world. And all language and concepts that we so far have is created to explain or designate or describe something that is inside the world. That is to say, that is inside space and inside time, and thereby is impermanent, is a process. But that's not the case with Nibbana. It's outside space, outside time. Because nothing begins there, then nothing ends there. There's no here, nor there, nor anything in between. Because it has no spatial characteristic. It is not in any form of space. It has no address. It is outside all addressing, referencing and pointing to. Because it is not included in the world. If it were included in the world, then it would not be the end of suffering. Because then it would be impermanent. It would not last. And then when you cling to whatever doesn't last, then you feel suffering. Another later development, not something spoken by the Buddha, but coming in with the commentaries over the centuries later, when this idea emerged, I cannot say exactly, but I'll guess that it is before our era, that is to say, in the next 200 years after the Buddha's death. There in the commentaries once said that normally consciousness always have an object. If it's visual context, a consciousness, then this object is either a form or a color. If it's auditory consciousness, then the object is either some form of a sound, for example, my voice or the bird. If it's gustatory or olfactory consciousness, then the objects are a kind of smell or a kind of taste. If it's tactile consciousness, then the object is any kind of touch on the skin or inside the body, a pressure, or the feel you can feel where your joints are, whether your knee is stretched out or whether it's bent. Or it can be feeling of pain, or it can be feeling of the stomach is full. There's also tactile consciousness. or it can be mental consciousness, then the consciousness is aware of any kind of idea, language, concept, or mental state, for example, an intoxicated mental state. Then what about Nibbana? Nibbana, was it speculated? One should not speculate, but the commentators said they speculated anyway. Nibbana could be a case of consciousness without an object. Consciousness without an object. It is aware. It is fully aware. But it doesn't have an object. It is aware of nothing. Thereby, it's pure awareness. It is the same as saying one is aware of everything at the same time, which is, of course, is impossible. So it can be seen as a kind of perceptual openness, complete openness. There could be any object in this mind, but there is none. There's no thinking. There's no seeing. There's no hearing. There's no smelling. There's no touching, tasting, and there's no touching. No object whatsoever. So consciousness without an object, aramanya vijnana in Pali, is the expression in the commentaries. From this, one may conclude that there is some mind, since Nibbana is an object of the mind. And since this the Buddha didn't say, there can be a form of consciousness. It's not a form of consciousness that we know of now, because all our consciousness has an object. But there can be a form of consciousness that doesn't have an object. These kinds of consciousness, one can come to get the taste of it, or see the shadow of, doing deep meditation, where all thinking is silenced, so there's no thinking going on. Second jhana, upwards. Fourth jhana, all perception of the body, all tactile impingement, sense impingement, is stopped. So there, though there's no thinking and no outer perception, there can still be some subtle form of inner perception. There can still be objects of the mind. When these objects of the mind has ceased, whatever they may be, then this consciousness that is there, what is left, there the person or the being doesn't breathe anymore. They're in a very low state of hibernation, but it's a fully aware state. They once asked Sariputta, what was the difference in one in fourth jhana and a dead person? And then Sariputta, he answered this, that the dead person there, all metabolism in the body has ceased. All the breathing has ceased. And the sensations has also ceased. And the mental abilities, they have also ceased. But in one who is in the fourth jhana, though breathing has ceased, then metabolism hasn't ceased and the body is still hot, if you feel it. But body temperature is probably low, down to around 20 degrees, I would guess, if they stay in 1 week in the fourth jhana. Though perception, sensation has ceased, their mental ability is extremely clear, he said. So they don't breathe, they don't move, They have a very low level of metabolism from oxygen in their myoglobin stores in the muscle, what actually makes the muscles red in color. That's myoglobin. In family with hemoglobin, which makes the blood red, which is the transport protein of oxygen. So you have an enormous stores of oxygen inside the muscles. This you can survive on for 1 week without breathing. Animals can also do that. Certain animals, diving down. So this points to that the less the body is involved, the more clear the mind comes to be. And this also points to the situation of Nibbana. If I say it's mind only, then I start to speculate. So I won't say that. One should focus on two things. Nibbana is an object of the mind. Two, Nibbana is the highest happiness. There's no need to know more, to speculate more. Because one has to go there and see for oneself anyway. So what's behind the carpet? What's behind the door? You'll see when you open the door, but not before. Anything before opening the door is speculation. Doesn't lead up to the door. It usually leads astray. So one starts running around after fantasies, imaginations, and so forth, that look like something in this world. Then you can conclude, if it looks like something in this world, then it's not Nibbana. Because Nibbana is not like something in this world. So, is it true that the mind doesn't die? No, mind does die. Does the mind stop at Nibbana? I don't know. Probably not. Probably not. Because Nibbana is an object of the mind. One way I've thought about it myself earlier, is that if mind is discrete blinks now, that comes very rapidly, billions of times per second, then what could happen is that instead of being discrete blinks of awareness, that is either visual awareness or auditory awareness or tactile awareness or mental awareness and so forth, then suddenly, at the entry to Nibbana, then mind becomes continuous. But it doesn't have any particular object. It is only mental consciousness, like now we are aware of an idea or for thinking or for mental state. So it's only this kind of consciousness. You don't take your eyes with you to the other side of Nibbana, or your body or any other sense organ with you. So it could be the case that what we think is continuous consciousness actually is discrete consciousness that is blinking along. And what is Nibbana is continuous, really continuous consciousness, but without change, without dynamics, without transience, and also without an object. Consciousness without an object. So much for question 159 at this point. It is something that I think all the commentaries and the commentators up through the ages, they love to discuss this issue. And they discuss this page up and page down. And that's a good sign that they might not know very much about what they're talking about. They have no direct experience of it themselves. And this one should avoid this tendency to intellectualization and speculation about it. The Buddha said like this. So there's a hen. If she doesn't lie on her eggs, she won't get any chickens. Whether she wants it or not, she won't get any chickens. Then there's another hen. She lies on the egg and protects the eggs. Then she gets chickens. Whether she wants it or not, she still gets chickens. Why so? She delivers the course. And the same thing with the Buddhist disciple. If they deliver the course, finalizing the Noble Eightfold Way, and thereby making all the 37 producers of enlightenment, all these 37 states, the Bodhipakkhya Dhamma, well, then enlightenment happens, whether they like it or not, whether they want it or not. So, whether you look at all these eggs from various kinds of sides and juggle around with them and kind of like, it doesn't help really, this intellectualization, this speculation. You cannot hammer Nibbana out with logic or with sound reasoning. One has to complete the Noble Eightfold Way. That's the only way. The only way. It's kind of like trying to jump the low fence. I can think my way to it. I don't need to do any meditation. I don't need to purify my morality. Because I just read these books and these texts and listen to these monks. And then I can become enlightened without doing any other job. But that's not the case. That's not the case. One has to do the job. One has to do the job. It pays off, certainly so, by the highest happiness. And nothing less than deathlessness. Deathlessness. No death itself. Only that is the end of suffering. So all this speculation, intellectualization, which is Westerners, Western Buddhists, is particularly prone to that. And the higher education they have, the more they speculate. So the more they close the door to Nibbana. Because they get lost in all this speculation. So be careful with that. 41 minutes. On we go. Question 160. How can we understand suffering in terms of Dhamma opportunity? Yes, some person knows to me that how to look at suffering and frustration and all these obstacles in life in a constructive way. The constructive way actually is to see, and this you ask all, if you ask all Buddhist disciples, including myself, and also if one asks them in their life, if they can remember any life, and afterwards when they see this life, then all the times they have come to the Dhamma and start to take the Dhamma seriously in this life, it has been after a period of very big suffering, very big suffering, a very big sorrow. It can be depression, loss of a family member, loss of job, loss of economy, or a lover goes away, or a child dies, or whatever obstacle or event in their life that caused deep happiness, unhappiness, sorrow, sadness, suffering, despair. Then suddenly the mind gives up this plan of trying to bend the world to make it happy. Say, okay, I have to go another way. And then what starts right there is faith. Satta, you carry in your heart. Devotion to the path, to the Buddha, the Dhamma and the Sangha. Satta. This is the first spiritual ability. It's a little finger, you can say. Then one starts to be enthusiastic with developing the path. That's energy, virya. That's the second ability. Then comes investigation, Dhamma Vichaya. Because there's investigation, and enthusiastic investigation, then it's also after awareness and concentration has been developed, then it ends with understanding, which is the fifth mental ability. Which is a power, because then you know how it is. The world has become a map, internalized map. So the model of the external and the internal world has been made so complete that Nibbana can be reached, because the map is there and the map is accurate. So the cause of faith, the little finger ability of the five spiritual abilities, the little finger ability comes from suffering. So suffering has these two sides. Suffering, dukkha, bad state. Du, bad, ka, state, moment. Dukkha, bad state, bad business. This comes from this. This has this, of course, this painful aspect. But the other side is it. Other side is it is the other side of the same coin, you can say. Is that it arises faith. The individual is hard-pressed and then starts looking for something else than money, porn, power, security, and sense pleasure. So it starts to looking for something else. What can I do? What can I do? I lost all my things. Now I feel big sorrow. I know I will lose all the things I get if I get a new thing, a new car, a new lover, a new job, a new Buddhist teacher, or go to a new meditation center, or take up a new religion, then the same will happen again. So what to do? Is there the faith in the Dhamma starts, and there the path also starts. So this suffering imminent in all life in the world is a gateway to the Dhamma, which is then the gateway to deathlessness, which is the end of suffering. So it has two sides. So this is a good way of looking at it, is to utilize this suffering as fuel, as the motor, as the ignition for developing the Noble Eightfold Way to Nibbana. This also goes with any obstruction along the way one meets. Whatever unfortunate things happen, one becomes sick, has to have a tooth extraction, or a heart operation, or a divorce, or go to court, or have a bank loan, or whatever, get a new job. Then once you see, this is a good training ground, say, how fortunate I am to get such a good training ground to develop my spiritual abilities, to hold my ground even faced with such worldly suffering, thereby gaining much more faith and enthusiasm in the Dhamma, thereby approaching Nibbana and deathlessness. So how happy I am, how fortunate I am that these obstacles, these problems, these multifarious kinds of suffering, they are flowing in on me continuously, day after day. How fortunate I am that this is happening. Because this gives me a good opportunity. So one sees the suffering, the obstacle, the frustration, the pain as an opportunity to develop. That is advantageous. If anything is, then that is advantageous. So one is turning the bad thing into a good thing. One is turning the detrimental, painful, disadvantageous thing into an advantage, an absolute advantage. That is skillful, skillful driving, skillful living. Clever, that is, of course, needless to say. Because one becomes very stable by that. Whether you have advantageous or neutral or detrimental circumstances flowing in from behind, from karmic causes created in the past, then whatever comes, then one it is utilized to develop the path further down the road, to increase the knowledge and understanding and concentration and awareness to approach deathlessness and Nibbana. I hope this answers questions number 160. Suffering is suffering, yes, but suffering also gives faith. Saddha, first ability, spiritual ability in the Dhamma. The last question goes like this. Question 161. What is the kammic effect of sensuous pleasures like masturbation? So, one can say by all behavioral patterns, there's 31 levels of existence in Buddhist cosmology, and humans are level 5. And so humans masturbate. There's animals also masturbate. The lower devas probably also masturbate, though I'm not sure about that. They at least copulate. But from level 11 up upwards, there they don't even copulate. And they have no sex. They also have no gender. They are neither male nor female. So there one, there they exist in the first jhana continuously, or upwards from first to fourth jhana, and then form jhana, and then from first to fourth formless jhana on the highest level, four highest levels. So whatever behavioral pattern one repeats in this life, then this recreate a future life on this ladder of the 31 levels of existence corresponding to where this behavior is still performed. So masturbation is not harmful in the sense that it harms others. It can harm oneself because it causes a loss of memory. This means to say, if you masturbate 12 times a day, then because of orgasm, it's orgasm itself, it's not the masturbation, but the orgasm itself, just like electroshock, cause short intermediate form of memory lapse, a loss of memory. So you cannot remember anything immediately after having an orgasm or an electroshock. In the case of electroshock, it depends on how many voltages you put on the inside the brain, how long the lack of memory will last. In normal electroshock given for people with severe depression that cannot be treated with medicine, then it lasts from something like 10 days to 2 or 3 weeks. That they cannot remember, for example, the address, and sometimes also the names of their relatives and so forth. So it's a severe lack of memory, loss of memory. The same goes for the habitual masturbator. What they have learned yesterday in school or at university or in life or by listening to this Dhamma talk, then because of these 2 or 3 or 5 orgasms a day, because of this masturbation, this is forgotten again. Then they have to relearn it. So all this kind of electroshocks, one in giving oneself by this orgasm, which is kind of like a cramped state, this reduces intelligence. Because short-term memory is severely reduced, and long-term memory even more reduced for a short time. Then one regains the abilities later down the road. So there's two levels of it, the coming effect of it. It can say it delimits the future state to being animal, human or animal or lower than that, or at the lower devas that still engage in fight and copulation, sexual mating, and also probably also masturbation, though I'm not sure about that. But I'm almost sure that on the next level, the level of the four kings, there they still masturbate. But nevertheless, so this means one cannot go higher than that. So the karmic effect is a kind of delineation of the degrees of freedom one has in one's future life. And this goes for all behaviors, that they delineate what future one can have, because their quality or lack of quality, their property, we can say in a neutral way, it points to a specific future state. So, in short, the karmic effect of masturbation is a lack of intelligence and ability to learn something in this life, here and now. And this will spill over to the same thing, lack of ability to learn, thereby lack of intelligence in a future life. And secondly, one cannot go higher than the lowest devas, and probably in the lower end of them. The same thing with among the human beings, one will be reborn in the lower end. And then according to other karma one have done in this conjunction, one do many other things than masturbation, of course, in a life, and have done so also in other lives, then they would add to or subdraw from the state. Animal state or ghost state or asura, demon state or hell state. So it is not neutral, one can say. we will say there's three kinds of karma. That's advantageous karma, kusala. That's disadvantageous karma, akusala. Then there's neutral karma, right in the middle. And this is a little bit on the akusala side, because it doesn't lead upwards. It's not advantageous. Can one stay in the same state? Yes, sir, one can. But when one will have, because of this indulgement, this addiction to sense pleasure, a particular kind of sense pleasure that cause lack of intelligence, lack of ability to remember, lack of ability to learn something, then it's slightly detrimental downwards. Slowly, regression into a more, as the devas say, gross state. Gross is one stop short of primitive. And I think most beings, if you see a monkey masturbate, or a dog masturbate using the tongue, or when you see another one masturbate, or if you film yourself masturbating and then see this film afterwards, then you would definitely say, this is a primitive activity. This is a primitive activity. This facial expression of people who masturbate look like animals, basically. Very primitive. When the devas call it gross, then it's a kind of being diplomatic. That they say the human world and activities like masturbations are gross. Then there is because of being diplomatic and kind to us. That they don't mention the word primitive. But that's what it is, and it rightly should be called. I hope this answers question 161. I should also like to say about this masturbation that masturbation and internet coming together, these two factors, has created an industry, the porn industry, which uses up 80% of all bandwidth on the internet. So I can only work at night on the internet because people, they sit masturbating in front of their computers all daytime from coming home to work until 2 o'clock at night. So 80% of all bandwidth is internet porn, and it's a multi-billion dollar industry. It's almost on par with the fiction film industry, the porn industry. And that is because there is something called mirror neurons inside the brain, that if you see somebody have sexual pleasure, then you get some kind of the same pleasure inside your own brain. But one can cut the connection to these mirror neurons by training. This one should do. Otherwise, one get caught up in this pornomania, which is one stop short of insane or crazy. At least we can say for sure it is primitive. I think everybody agrees about that. Those who make the porn, earn money on porn, those who buy the porn and use the porn, and those who masturbate, they can all agree upon that this activity is primitive. It is far from divine, and it's even further from noble. It is not going towards Nibbana. It is bagging out, down into the primitive, down into the fire. So much for that. This ends Dhamma on Air number 48. Again, I'd like to say thank you to the donors, both the regular donors and the occasional donors, and in particular to the supporters who gave food the last time, and also even more in particular to those who donated the website whatbuddhasaid.net and all security servers and software connected with this Dhamma sharing facility, reaching 100,000 people every day. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your attention. Remember to click subscribe down there in the corner. If you want to receive more information or support this activity, then click the small eye or hover over this corner with your mouse. Then there will come a small eye. Click the small eye, then there will be a drop-down menu of 5 items. Have a nice day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha.